I'd now like to turn things over to Professor David Armitage, who is Lloyd C. Blankfein Professor of History at Harvard University and a member of the steering committee of the Folger Institute Center for the History of British Political Thought. Author of 18 books, Professor Armitage is also completing an edition of John Locke's colonial writings, which is part of the happy impetus for the seminar that this session kicks off. David, won't you please introduce our presenters and set the scene for today's session?
Thank you so much, Owen. Yes, indeed, I am David Armitage of Harvard University, and I'm joining you today from Cambridge, Massachusetts, on the land of the Massachusetts people. It is my enormous pleasure to introduce this session under the auspices of the Center for the History of British Political Thought, which is in turn under the Folger Institute, which is in turn embedded within the Folger Shakespeare Library. As many of you may be aware, the Folger Shakespeare Library is currently under spectacular refurbishment, and therefore we have both the disadvantage of not meeting in three dimensions, but also the great advantage of being able to bring together people through my estimate, 8 time zones from the west coast of the US to Cambridge, England. And this unique opportunity allows us to discuss an issue of pressing concern to multiple fields now. This particular gathering is radically overdetermined in the number of motivations which have led to bringing this particular group of people together, not just this evening, which is a public event, but also over the course of the next day and a half, when we'll be having a workshop based on pre-circulated papers for a group of selected participants under the auspices of the Center for British Political Thought. And it's my particular pleasure to welcome you on behalf of the steering committee of the center, which is myself, Sharon Achenstein, Julia Rudolph, and Nigel Smith. This particular event on John Locke and England's empire is the successor in many ways to a very successful and powerful indeed webinar, which was held at the Folger Library under our auspices earlier this year over the summer as part of the Folger's series of critical race conversations. On that occasion, we were very fortunate indeed to have Robert Bernasconi and Jennifer Morgan in conversation with the late, and I should also say great, Charles Mills, who passed away just a few weeks ago. In fact, the very last essay, as far as I know, that Charles Mills published before his terrible and untimely death was an essay on Locke and slavery, something he had been meditating on for some time but had not previously published on at length. But that particular essay published earlier this year, about 6 months ago, was exemplary of exactly the kinds of motivations which have led to this gathering today. That is, to bring together political theorists, philosophers, historians of all kinds, historians, literary historians, religious historians, intellectual historians, on the common ground of considering the relationship between John Locke on the one hand and England's empire, particularly in the Atlantic world, but not only in the Atlantic world, within the same frame, in order to see how these different academic disciplines with their different focuses of interest in Locke and the empire could come together and can come together indeed to create rich conversations which will cross-fertilize the relations among those fields and deepen our understanding both of Locke, Lockean traditions in philosophy, political thought and political theory, and also our understandings of English colonialism and the British Empire to core, and indeed perhaps also of global history. This therefore is a product of the current movement or set of converging movements to decolonize the history of political thought, which itself arises from a series of earlier overlapping and again intersecting movements that foregrounded Locke in relation to questions of empire, that is to matters of slavery, of property, of indigenous agency and the dispossession of indigenous peoples, of resource extraction, of mercantilism, and of religious establishment and toleration. Now these movements, although we now think of them in the framework of a broader movement to decolonize intellectual history, have very deep roots, indeed going back to the 18th century. Even in the early 18th century, there were still memories of Locke's place on the Board of Trade in the 1690s, towards the end of the 18th century. Critics of what they would term republicanism, but we might call perhaps slightly confusingly liberalism, critics such as Josiah Tucker and Jeremy Bentham, used the knowledge of Locke's involvement with the Carolina colony and its fundamental constitutions as a stick with which to beat not just Locke, but a Lockean tradition, especially that emerging in and around the era of the American Revolution. However, if we come closer to our own time, we can see that this particular confluence of interests in Locke on the one hand and empire very broadly on the other has more proximal roots in the expansion of archival material available to study Locke, particularly after the deposition of Locke's own personal papers at the Bodleian Library, thanks to the labors of Peter Laslett and how those were articulated with the Shaftesbury papers in the Public Record Office, as it then was, the National Archives, as they now are. And particularly Laslett himself did a great deal to lay the groundwork for repositioning Locke, especially the later Locke, in relation to his administrative and colonial activities in the latter part of his life. But gathering speed in the 1980s, again, through the efforts of multiple fields, the critiques of liberalism associated with scholars such as Uday Singh Mehta and James Tully, in particular, focused on Locke and his relationship to colonialism in the 17th century. But that also intersected very quickly in the early 1990s with the move to write the history of political thought about empire and the intellectual justifications for empire associated with the work of Barbara Arneal, Richard Tuck, Anthony Pagden, and others at that point. Now, this foundational work over these generations since the 1950s has been given greater impetus and sharpness more recently by precisely the decolonial approaches to intellectual history and the burgeoning historiographies of the Atlantic world, of slavery, of racial capitalism, and of the various fields which have been reshaped by these tectonic shifts in their concerns and also the outpouring of new knowledge and critical perspectives which have been generated by this work. Now, Locke has been central to many, if not all, of these movements, and therefore we thought in the steering committee of the center that this would be a very good moment to survey exactly where we are in studies of Locke and empire, and also where we might go from here as well. And to that end, we gathered together both the scholars who will be discussing their work in progress over the next day and a half, and also two of the scholars who have done most to help us to reframe the questions about Locke and empire, in particular within the fields of history and of political theory. And so I will introduce briefly our two speakers who will kick off our discussion this evening now. They are, in order of speaking, Mark Goldie, who is currently Professor of Intellectual History Emeritus at the University of Cambridge and also an honorary Professor of History at the University of Sussex. Mark is the author of more than 70 articles, many of them on Locke and his contexts, and he's also the editor of Locke's political essays, of his writings on toleration, and an edition of the Second Treatise, among many other books as well. He's now working on a biographical study of the late John Locke, that is the post-revolutionary John Locke, or as he described it earlier, the post-colonial John Locke, the post-revolutionary John Locke, maybe now seen through a post-colonial lens, as indeed Mark himself helped us to do through his series of Carlyle lectures at Oxford earlier this year, laying out some of the fruits of that discussion on Locke and empire. So he is particularly well placed to bring the historian's perspective on Locke and empire, especially the later Locke as well. And our second speaker this evening is Vicki Hsueh, who is Professor of Political Science at Western Washington University, where she also currently directs the Women, Gender and Sexuality Studies program. Among Vicki's many publications are a series of groundbreaking articles on Locke and colonial constitutionalism and indigenous traditionalisms and New World knowledges, many parts of which fed into her important book, Hybrid Constitutions, Making and Unmaking Power and Privilege in Colonial America, which has been a major point of reference since its publication in 2010 for discussions of Locke, empire, and the implications of that nexus for political theory and political thought. So without further ado, I'll invite Mark and then Vicki to speak for about 15 or 20 minutes each on the topic of Locke and empire. And then in the remaining time, we will open this up for discussion from the floor. So Mark, please.
David, thank you very, very much for that wonderful introduction. I'm speaking to you from Cambridge, England, where it's quite late in the evening here. And this is where I've been based for a very long time and thinking or trying to think about Locke for quite a lot of that period as well. As I was saying earlier to some colleagues, I never expected in my youth to study John Locke, since I was trained to avoid the great canon of political theorists. But there's something very magnetic about Locke, and for a historian in particular, the sheer fact of the vast archive that he left behind in the Bodleian Library and elsewhere is something that draws one to him. Well, today, as a result of some of the trends that have already been outlined by David, I think the reputation of John Locke is Janus-faced. Many still do applaud him as the godparent of liberal democracy and as an honorary founding father of the American Constitution and independence. At the same time, others now take him to be emblematic of the entanglement of early liberalism with empire. And it's now commonly argued that Locke justified colonial expropriation and Atlantic slavery. And if I can just interrupt myself here at this point to, I hope not to light a note, in Cambridge, England, a few weeks ago, a very nice example of this juxtaposition occurred. On a Sunday in September, the Observer newspaper contained an article on how the Anglosphere's concept of liberty should not domineer. And it stated that Locke was, on the one hand, the philosopher of liberalism, but on the other, had justified slavery and had invested in the Royal African Company. Well, the following day on the Monday, the Locke Hotel opened in Cambridge, founded by, it's a small chain of hotels, founded by a great admirer of John Locke, and each room in the hotel has quotations from the great man, and we're told that he is a great figure of the Enlightenment. So this, I think, is a very nice example of the juxtaposed Janus face of Locke. Well, as David has again begun to explain to us, from about 1990, there was a post-colonial turn in Locke's studies, where hitherto his two treatises of government was almost entirely interpreted within the context of domestic British-English history, construed in terms of the Whig struggle against the tyranny of the House of Stuart. Now the book came to be seen in the context of English colonization. And whereas Locke's references to America had previously been treated, if at all, purely as metaphorical, were now taken very literally indeed. And the book, particularly the fifth chapter on property, taken to be part of a deliberate program to legitimate imperial projects. Now that post-colonial turn has owed a great deal to outstanding scholars like James Tully and Barbara Arnail and David himself. And in their hands, the treatment of Locke remains nuanced and richly informed by the archive. But I do have to say there are a lot of people who are not close scholars of Locke, for whom Locke, in inverted commas almost, has become simply emblematic, a kind of denotive label for the liberal imperial entanglement, and a straw man in the culture war, the connective tissue that demonstrates that liberalism and slavery were born twins. Well, I want first to note here that there's an irony, I think, that the post-colonial critique relies on what some might argue is a rather old-fashioned reading of Locke as liberal. There's been quite a lot of scholarship in recent years that wants to detach Locke from the genealogy of liberalism. And a lot of scholarship ever since John Donne's major work of 1969, right down to recent articles by Duncan Bell and Tim Stanton, have wanted to question this genealogy of Locke and liberalism. And it is a strange fact that both the friends and the critics of Locke both insist or require that he be the emblematic philosopher of liberalism. And I think that in itself needs challenging. And I think there are a lot of reasons for doubting Locke's credentials as a liberal. One thing I am discovering in my studies of Locke in the late, in the 1690s is how committed he was to governmental dirigism. Many of the friends of Locke now see him as the defender of minimalist government, but I do not myself find him a defender of governmental minimalism. If you look at his chapter on the prerogative, it's in fact a sustained defense of executive power. And I think that he is a very serious theorist, not only of legislative supremacy, but also of executive power. But we need to turn to Locke and empire. It is, I think, a rather peculiar fact about the post-colonial turn that it has tended to focus almost overwhelmingly on early Locke, the Locke of around 1670. Now, there are obviously very good reasons for this. The desire to trace the intellectual evolution of the two treatises, the fact that he served as secretary to the proprietors of Carolina, that he helped to draft the fundamental constitutions of Carolina, about which Vicki has written with such insight, and the notorious, now notorious fact that briefly in 1673, Locke invested in the Royal African Company, whose function was to supply enslaved people to America. But I think there is an oddity about this emphasis on early Locke, because he was then only a secretarial subordinate, whereas after the revolution of 1688, he became one of the English state's most powerful officials. And I hope there'll be a bit more focus on the Locke of the 1690s, when he was a founder member of the Board of Trade and Plantations. Under William III, Locke was not a mere secretary, but in effect a junior minister in government, and he did govern America, or attempted to do so, for 4 years, from 1696 to 1700. He was a senior policymaker in what historians identify as the growing fiscal, military, imperial state. I think there's a simple reason why there hasn't been much focus on Locke at the Board of Trade, and I think that is an archival one. To be frank, political scientists tend not to go to archives. They tend to rely on the published existing texts that are readily available for us. But I, and David as well, have been delving in recent years in the Board of Trade papers, and they're a wonderful resource, which I don't think either of us have fully mined by any means yet. There are five volumes of minutes of the Board of Trade in his period, and underneath that, something like 80 volumes supporting it. And there are at least 200 documents signed by Locke. And this is a treasure trove from the archive that we're only beginning to touch. They cover a multitude of commercial and colonial matters: Ireland, Scotland, war against French Canada, piracy, the law of the sea, land claims by colonialists and Native Americans, the wool trade, the poor law, the Baltic timber trade for the British Navy. And I think we have to keep in mind that empire, of course, entailed not only the American continent, but the West Indies. And in fact, when Locke uses the phrase West Indies in the two treatises, I think he's still using it in the older meaning to mean the whole of the Americas, the West Indies, as opposed to the East Indies. We also have to bear in mind that empire was not only about the land, but the sea, the oceans. Lauren Benton's work has drawn to our attention how important in the development of imperialism is the thinking about the control of the oceans and the seas. And for example, Locke was very preoccupied with the topic of piracy and what counted as piracy. What is a privateer? What is a pirate? What is the power of the state to declare who shall be called and named a pirate and therefore an outlaw? And incidentally, I think there are fascinating parallels with the two treaties' notion of tyranny as an outlaw and the politics of piracy on the high seas. There's also the Three Kingdoms dimension. And I do want to say as an aside that we really must call Locke an exponent of the English Empire and not the British. And I'm afraid North Americans, if you'll allow me to say this, too often call him British. He was English. There was no polity of Britain while Locke was alive. And in the 1690s, Locke as a policymaker is on the verge of, in fact, declaring war on Scotland, which had its own colonial project in Panama, in Darien, as it was called. Now, one important thing about Locke in the 1690s is that he's already, of course, published the two treatises of government. You could argue, if you go back to the early Locke of 1670, that he may well have changed his mind. There's a notorious slave clause in the fundamental constitution of Carolina of 1669. You could argue that he changed his mind. But that's no longer possible, partly because of the case that David has shown, that Locke remains committed to the fundamental constitution of Carolina all the way through the rest of his career. But we can underscore that very much from the materials in the Board of Trade. For example, and I don't have time to go into it here, and I was giving a lecture on this subject at the University of Sussex last week, if you look at the discussions of slavery in the Board of Trade documents, it's absolutely clear that Locke accepts the institution of the Atlantic slave trade, the dealing in African people across the Atlantic. How that fits with his theory is a huge question and remains a very difficult and tricky one to tackle. But I think it's unquestionably clear that in his dealings on the Board of Trade, he accepts that institution. That material, though, does propose methodological dilemmas, and it's actually a much broader question of how we're going to address, and I don't have the answer to this, how we're going to address the relationship between philosophy and practical politics. We all confront that in our own lives. We always constantly say, well, in theory, ideally, I would prefer this state of affairs, but as things are, we have to accept this or that. Is Locke simply in that position? How are we to deal with the disparity between philosophy and practice and policy? If we're thinking about Locke and empire, in a sense, we're thinking about a treatise Locke never wrote. We struggle to make the two treatises of government fit or explain or help us understand Locke and empire, but it's not clear that it was ever intended to do so. It's a theory for the pathology of states gone wrong. It remains still primarily a theory about the right of resistance against a tyranny. Locke never wrote a treatise on political economy, on empire, and I think we need to piece together what that treatise might have looked like. I think our whole project this weekend is a kind of Hamlet without the prince. That is to say that it is a Locke who did not in fact write a sustained treatise about empire, political economy, executive power. We can only find hints of it in the two treatises and in his policy documents and memoranda. But I do think there is one passage in the second treatise that's really a guide to what we're talking about here this weekend. And it's a passage that he inserted in 1698. When you look at the two treatises, it's not obvious always to the reader, unless you delve away in the footnotes, to see which passages, and there are several hundred words, that he added in 1698. When he was in the Board of Trade, and it's a famous phrase about the great art of government. And I think it's a manifesto for Locke as an imperial policymaker. He talks about the increase of the productivity of lands and the right employing of them being the great art of government, and that the prince who shall be so wise and godlike to secure protection and encouragement to the industry of mankind will be too hard for his neighbors. There's so much in that passage about the art of government, as opposed to the, as it were, ground rule theory of government, about the prince who should be wise and godlike. Here's the great critic of the divine right of kings saying that what we want is a wise and godlike prince who will guide the productive powers of the application of hands to lands. And that this will make us too hard for our neighbors. This is geopolitics. This is Locke talking about the power of the English state in relation to, in competition with, particularly, of course, France, he has in mind, and he has been fighting, contributing to the fight of the Great War. I'll stop in just a minute. I just want, in my last couple of points, to say that two things. One is that the term empire, as late as around 1700, needs a bit of caution. It still denoted imperium, the old classical notion of sovereignty or jurisdiction, or simply rule. It was only beginning, just beginning to mean territorial extent in our modern sense. So I think we have to keep that in mind when we speak about imperium, empire, and the idea of empire. My last point is this, that if we look at the early reception of Locke, the early afterlives of the two treatises, we find something very interesting happening even before he died. Locke's book may be construed and is now being very much construed as a defense of colonialism, empire, slavery. But it also and remains a theory of liberation. It was written as such. And his readers, before he even died, began to point out the contradiction between Locke the theorist and Locke in government. And this is particularly true of Scots and Irish and New York colonists. By the turn of the century, by 1698-1701, they're all in effect saying, Mr. Locke now sits on the Board of Trade and is exerting the powers of the British government, the English government, over the colonies and Ireland and Scotland. And yet in his book, he expressed a thesis that would offer us the tools, the conceptual tools, to be free of the power of the metropole. The clearest case, or the most famous case of this, is William Molyneux's Case of Ireland of 1698, a book which for the first time names John Locke as the author of the two treatises. And in effect, that book said, when did Ireland consent to be ruled by England? I read Mr. Locke's book, when did Ireland consent to be ruled? So we find the Janus face of Locke there in a different phase, in a different form. Here, the Locke articulating the power of the English government in London, and yet he has published a book which will soon be used against the power of London. Thank you.
Thank you, Mark, for that wonderful introduction. And over to you, Vicki, please.
Well, thank you so much. I'm so grateful to the Folger, to you, David, to Mark Goldie, to Owen Williams, and of course, the seminar participants. I have long admired and been inspired by Mark's and David's research and writing. And so for me, this is truly a very special and wonderful opportunity to talk, share, and reflect. I have to confess, I can't wait to talk about Mark's presentation. So of course, after my little contribution, I definitely welcome your questions and comments. For political theorists, few figures have so powerfully represented the entanglements of early modern English colonialism and constitutionalism as John Locke. As both Mark and David have mentioned, groundbreaking work by James Tully, Barbara Arneal, Bhikkhu Parekh, and Herman Leibovitz, among others, drew upon Locke's various connections to colonial ventures to revise longstanding conceptions of property, labor, liberal and democratic thought, limited government, and freedom. Locke's standard of greatest conveniences, as the theorist James Tully famously argued, not only privileged colonial farming, settlement, and trade, but ultimately functioned to make the English acquisition of indigenous American territories appear familiar and customary. More subtle than simple exclusion, Locke's account helped to shape what Tully calls the prevailing language of modern constitutionalism, which, quote, is viewed in contrast to an ancient or historically earlier constitution and establishes a competing tradition of rights, virtues, and manners set against the customs of non-European societies viewed as at an earlier or lower stage of historical development. Most of all, in Tully's formulation, the captivating picture of the inevitable and benign progress of modern constitutionalism replaces and covers over the real history of the interaction of European imperialism and Aboriginal resistance. The impact of this research taken collectively on the field has been significant. Where once questions of empire, indigenous polities, and colonial appropriation were absent, or even worse, disavowed. With now more than 25 years of scholarship in the making, it seems abundantly clear that the subject of Locke's colonial agenda has now been fully declared. that captivating picture, we might say, has been taken down. And while earlier scholarship in political theory tended to focus on Locke's justification of territorial appropriation and cultural assimilation, the most recent work in the field has drawn on Locke's connections to colonial ventures to address an impressively wide range of subjects. Recent studies include, but are not limited to, the politics of sugar, the politics of deforestation, the politics of money, trust, and the interest rate, and the politics of home and homelessness. Notably, what animates current research is not simply resisting the captivating picture of modern constitutionalism, as Tully once called for, but rather a more urgent and more impassioned project of identifying what the theorist Kevin Brunel describes as settler colonial logic. That canny logic which enforces and naturalizes indigenous territorial dispossession and indigenous people's disempowerment, and when disavowed, leaves unscathed, in Brunel's words, the notions of foundational abundant land and liberal individualist subjectivity that are central to the American Lockean tale of the self-made autochthonous American. And here I want to say the question of Locke's connection to settler colonial logic is worth unpacking a bit more slowly. For Brunel and a number of other theorists, Locke still remains the linchpin in what is now a tarnished American liberal tradition that sees and disavows indigenous people, indigenous territorial presence, and settler colonialism. Libby Anker, for example, similarly, as Brunel, turns to Locke, particularly Locke's association with the Carolina colony and Barbados, to better understand what she describes as liberalism, liberal freedoms, disavowed practices. As she asks, how might liberal notions of universal freedom and individual personhood enable and depend upon land theft, forced labor, resource extraction, and hierarchical systems of racism and civilization? While it might be the case, as Vanita Seth explains, that liberalism and empire both hold a resonance, a legibility, and a political and contemporary currency that other terms do not, both terms, I would argue here, are inadequate characterizations of Locke's colonial writing and thinking. As Mark very rightly mentioned earlier, much critical work has already been done that corrects and tempers attributions of liberalism to Locke. And Locke's imperial vision was largely limited to empire as sovereignty or imperium, as David Armitage clarifies. So the problem for political theorists, I believe, is not a mistake of anachronism. To be sure, employing the categories of liberalism and empire enables theorists to highlight the contemporary relevance of their work, as it also enables them to participate more directly in the political rhetoric of the present, especially the ever-intensifying discussions of race and oppression today, which themselves consolidate around the limitations and injuries of liberal freedoms and rights. At the same time, I believe political theory's frequent recourse to the categories of liberalism and empire neglects the different contours and features of the various colonial ventures, projects, agendas, and processes at work in the period and within Locke's writing more particularly. And this trade-off comes with risks. As Barbara Arneal has recently commented, the words colonialism and colonization are increasingly not used to describe the processes through which various kinds of colonies were created or justified, but instead as metaphors for various profoundly negative forms of domination. And decolonization has simultaneously become a metaphor for resisting these various kinds of racialized domination in particular. There is a problem with this, Arneal writes, namely that it obscures and elides the concrete historical processes of colonization and decolonization. Even more importantly, I would argue, reliance on the categories of liberalism and empire cannot do the work of fully responding to what has been now the stated problematic of settler colonial logic. That is to say, the outsized focus on liberalism and empire as composite state dramatically underplays and sidelines the proliferation of political languages, discourses, and forms in the early modern period, and to great consequence, particularly if the goal is to reevaluate the disavowed knowledge's independence of colonial arguments. Our understanding as political theorists need to include more active engagement with the entwined emergence of colonization and constitutionalism. So as Marx suggests, a turn to the archives and a more nuanced understanding of Locke's connections to colonialism early and late offer political theorists much needed resources for shifting the focus away from liberalism and addressing different political categories and concepts, and for better understanding the complex dynamics of power and privilege at work in colonial and political discourses of the past and the present. And here I just want to touch upon two examples of colonialism and constitutionalism, namely proprietary constitutionalism and corporate constitutionalism, that can be fruitfully explored via Locke's life and writings. As I have argued in previous work, Locke's association with the Carolina settlement offers a rich example for expanding political theory's conceptions of English colonialism and constitutionalism. Examining Locke's contributions to the fundamental constitutions, along with a consideration of his duties as the secretary to the Lord's proprietors, enables us to see a proprietary constitutionalism that was polyvocal and far from uniform. Composed of a variety of written and unwritten instruments, proprietary constitutions were neither fully ancient nor wholly modern. The fundamental constitutions, in particular, was composed of an ambiguous hybrid of civic humanist, republican, and feudal discourses in the period, along with some notably repressive and authoritarian tendencies. And although the fundamental constitutions was never implanted in full in the Carolinas, the Lord Proprietors created temporary constitutions modeled on its features and encouraged colonists to pursue prudence and discretion in their adaptation of languages and skills from local indigenous tribes. Adaptation was certainly a proprietary strategy to facilitate colonial interests and ambitions, but it took form in ways that cannot be captured in the matrix of liberalism and empire. More ambiguous and elastic in its openness to useful knowledge and local practices, adaptation seemed to facilitate what we might characterize as an opportunism. This constitutionalism did not require or enforce stable categories of identity. Instead, local conditions and events determine the salience of particular choices, and thus contingency and ambition often worked hand in hand. Second, I would suggest Locke's colonial life beyond the proprietary colonies helps direct us to other forms of colonial constitutionalism. For example, Locke's investment in and involvements with 17th century English trading corporations, notably the Royal Africa Company, the East India Company, and especially Locke's role on the Board of Trade, as Marx suggests, could be taken up fruitfully by theorists as an important opportunity to assess the global activities of the 17th century English trading corporations, with particular attention to the protean, contested, dialogic, and creative dimensions of their constitutional activity. As the historian William Pettigrew has argued, English trading corporations were protagonists in developing England's involvement with non-European trade, and they should be seen as discrete constitutional entities which operated in multiple settings around the world and at various local, national, and transnational registers. Corporate constitutionalism, Pettigrew contends, did not exhibit the unbroken extension of power from center to periphery. Dependent on state authority, yet also often virtually autonomous in their overseas operations, corporations were both reflective and refractive of state constitutional mechanisms because their constitutional provisions were so often renegotiated both at home and abroad. Further complicating their legal standing, corporations were also part of the polyglot, contentious, and pluralist legal and political cultures of the period. This corporate constitutionalism thus paints a very different picture of colonial governance and identity than is typically associated with Locke by political theorists, and it's one that is more flexible and responsive to non-European interests. As Pettigrew explains, quote, corporations required political support and constitutional privilege to gather and protect investment. sustaining this support and privilege depended upon the establishment and maintenance of trade. Durable trading relationships depended upon the countenance of foreigners. Corporations therefore relied upon the agency and initiative of their non-European customers and suppliers, and at times the need to calibrate corporate interest with the commercial interests of their non-European hosts provoked near desperation among corporate actors, end quote. If the discipline of political theory is to loosen the grip of liberalism's empire and to address the tactics and strategies of settler colonial logic, it will need to not only challenge and critique familiar and dominant categories, but move beyond them. It will not be enough to simply disavow the liberal individualist subjectivity often credited to Locke, nor will it be sufficient to characterize settler colonial logic solely as a logic of elimination. A more comprehensive grappling with the colonial past will require, I suggest, theorizing less familiar forms of constitutionalism and attending to that period's pluralist and hybrid constitutional terms. It will also require what Andrew Murphy calls a multi-generic interpretive approach to political texts, one that can encompass journals, memoranda, correspondences, petitions, charters, ledgers, records, and promotional materials, as well as treatises, pamphlets, and tracts. Such work, I believe, increases the possibility of contesting narratives about the emergence of modern constitutionalism, while also unearthing alternative understandings that bring new features of colonialism's instrumentality, dependencies, and insecurities to the surface. In addition, conceptually precise and power-laden understandings of both proprietary constitutionalism and corporate constitutionalism could yield powerful and compelling insights, not simply for theorists, but for many others concerned by the evasions and strategies of colonies and corporations past and present. So thank you.
Thank you so very much, Vicki. So thank you to both of our opening speakers for those lucid, compelling, original, and sweeping statements, each delivered with impeccable concision.